Directed by heads of state, our CDS for their times on force now to plan on how to capture Kismayo. Even though Kismayo was in sector 2, the KDF sector. The other troops contributing countries in Amisom insisted that they must participate. They must participate in the capture of Kismayo, even though it was a KDF target. Why? Because of the importance, the historical importance attached to the capture of the port of Kismayo. Nobody had ever done it before.
You wanted to be part of that success?
We accepted. And we got all our top commanders together to plan on how to eventually capture it. Because we are still far away from Kismayo that time. But he's at Somalia though. And in between January of 2012 up to early June, early July, we had several meetings with my colleagues of AMISOM. I would host them here. They would come, go through the plan, they say, tweak this one. I'll not come from this way, I'll come from this direction, depending on where you're located in Somalia. Because the entry of KDF also is the one that introduced the concept of sectorization of the operational area. I'm the one who came up with it, because between 2005 up to 2011, I told you AMISOM was only in Mogadishu, controlling three buildings, the state house, the port, and I don't know what else. Out there, Al-Shabaab was roaming freely, the entire Somalia. And when we got in there, we said, if you are going to join AMISOM, then each country must be allocated its own sector. And because I had seen it in Yugoslavia when I served there in 92, 93 as a peacekeeper, I said, this is the way it works. You cannot be going out on Saturday and you come to Mogadishu in the evening. And Al-Shabaab is all over. And Somalia is a large country, very large and complex. So gradually, that concept was accepted in Addis Ababa, and we were allocated. In fact, I insisted our sector would be where we are, between sector 2, in Jubaland. We already established there anyway. Gedo region, which neighbors Mandera County, was allocated to Gedo Juba and Lower Juba, all the way down to the Indian Ocean. So now, we continue this planning how to capture Kismayo. And my last briefing, which we held in Witsa Club, in a sanitized environment, we were all there, top guns. I had my generals with me. They listened. We now have like a month and a half to go before the elections in Somalia. For lack of better words, they pulled out. For lack of better words, they pulled out one by one. So Kenya was left with the burden of capturing Kismayo alone.
Were they giving any reasons for pulling
out? The reasons were there, but they were unanimous to the country. They are not going to participate. I don't want to give the reasons. Too complex, blah, blah, blah. And we, because I would provide all the logistics of when we were here, I told my officers, okay, see our guest host to the airport to fly back home. Come back. We were there until 8 o'clock at night. And they told me, sir, what are you going to do now? This is gentlemen. What if this goes wrong? What could happen? You know, who is going to reinforce whom in case this guy does not get to his target? All those details were there. So those kind of details you don't go giving to everybody. You only give to those, as we say in the military, on the need to know.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have to know something, why should you know? You need to know principle. So the deception and the element of surprise. Surprise is also another principle of war.
Mm-hmm.
Surprise. So I appear where you don't expect me to appear. So,
Now,
that is exactly what we did. This was the launching of the operation at Alert 3. This let me remember it.
Yes.
Remember that tree?
Yeah.
Huh? That tree, which is now a shrine, huh? Mm-hmm. Who is a shrine now? And I also
mind you, even the battle that are documented here, none of them was easy. Each one of them was unique in his own way. We lost soldiers in 4 years. In 4 years, during my time, because I stayed there for 4 years, and if you go to any military camp, I think you must have visited, you see there is a monument.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And you want to do the concept of monument and the names of whoever you lost where at the date. In aggregate, other than accidents and all that, at the 3 soldiers. And,
In the span of 4 years. Now,
in actual battle.
Now, let's go back. We started with the...
So, of course, Kismayu, because of the signature and the importance globally that is attached to it,
yes.
you could say, that was the climax. But that did not signify the end of the war.
Mm.
Because Al-Shabaab is still there.
Mm.
And Al-Shabaab is not there because they are very strong. Before our entry, Al-Shabaab had moved from a radical kind of organization into a fairly formed up fighting force. They had anti-aircraft guns, they had serviced their missiles against aircraft that they used to fire at us, you know. But what you have, because there is no way, I must say, when you are fighting what you call a fourth generation warfare, also referred to as asymmetric warfare or war among people, all those are various names of the same type of war.
Mm.
When you're fighting an insurgency, you know the insurgents live among the people,
mm-hmm.
like the Mau Mau, for example.
Mm-hmm.
They live among people.
Yeah.
You don't fight in the shifter campaign that I mentioned here started 6 months before it became independent. Why did it start?
Mm-hmm.
Somalia became independent ahead of Kenya. So there were talks in London, in Lancaster House, about, of course, the British were the colonizers. British and the Italians were the colonizers in Somalia.
Mm-hmm.
The British were here also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jubalat was the British. This country was under the British.
Mm.
So, a referendum was held. A referendum in this country was held before we became independent. And that referendum, which was headed by somebody from Canada, Nigeria, and which other country, had only 2 questions. After Kenya becomes independent, you people of northern Kenya had a northern frontier district, NFD, which is today Northeastern Province.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about the counties of Mandera, Wajir, Garissa, Tana River,
Isiolo,
Marsabit, Abomey, people of northern Kenya, and NFD, and part of the Coast Province because of the Muslim factor, like Boni Forest. All the way along the coast of the world. So the referendum was about when Kenya becomes independent, and is going to become independent in 1963, which country would you like to belong to? Overwhelmingly, those people, I think it was, the outcome was like 62% of that referendum, plebiscite, voted to be part and parcel of Somalia. So the other 38, who are they? Because if you take Israel northwards, it's not entirely Islamic.
Mm-hmm.
I
I hope you expect this from my discussion.
Yeah.
It's part of education. If you take for example, our CS treasurer, the attorney, he is from Masabit.
Yeah.
But he's a Christian.
Mm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So between Isiolo and Moyale, near the Ethiopian border, the small tribe who live there essentially are the Baranas, who are all Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the Gabras, who are Christians. Then you have a smattering of Rediras, Brujis, Tukanas, some Merus in Isiolo there and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is a small tribe, or no, clan rather, in Isiolo called Dagodia.
Dagodia,
yes. A Somali clan. So these others who said you do not want to be part of Somalia are the Christians.
Mm-hmm.
But majority, the decision is based on the majority vote. Well, they said you want to be part of Somalia. There was a political party called the NPPP, the Northern People's Political Party. And it's in the papers today also?
Yes.
It was headquartered in Mogadishu.
Mm.
And this referendum was conducted at the behest of this political party.
Mm.
So they voted to be part of Somalia, Greater Somalia.
Mm.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Greater Somalia meaning wherever the Muslims are, huh?
Mm-hmm.
The Somali clans are, which is essentially today's NEP.
Mm.
And then you have in southern Ethiopia, the Ogaden region,
mm-hmm.
and then you have the whole of the entire, Djibouti, and of course Somalia itself.